Hello, this is Benjamin Boyce, and welcome to my podcast, or interview circuit. Today's guest is Francois Margolin, who is a French filmmaker and has been, the last 20, 25 years, been documenting the Taliban and ISIS and various other radical Islamic sects within Asia and Africa and the Middle East. In this interview, we talk about his new film, Jihadists, which has just now been released digitally. Unfortunately, because of the graphic nature of the content, Amazon Prime has restricted its viewing from just your regular streaming service. You actually have to go out of your way and purchase this film, which is very unfortunate because it is a very, very intense and close look at the leaders within these groups. In this interview, Francois speaks about the making of this film, the danger of making this film, and the impact that he hopes this film has on the West's attitude towards Islam in general and towards these radical sects in particular. All that being said, here's Francois.
Well, thanks for meeting with me. I've been watching your film. I haven't been able to view the whole thing, but I've watched a large portion of it. It's very powerful.
Yes, I hope it will be, I don't know if it's a world successful, but it's very interesting for the people, because I think nobody did it before, so and after also, yes. Because to meet the leaders of Al-Qaeda and some theorists of Salafism, nobody did it, because it's very, very dangerous, very risky, very complicated to do. And it's the reason I'm very happy to show it in New York and in LA, and I hope maybe in other cities in the future, because I think it's very important for French audience, but also for American audience, because it's not a French problem, it's a world problem.
Yeah. What prompted you to do this? So what you've done is you've gone into various places in the Middle East and in Africa. I saw a lot of it was in Mali, which is in West Africa. And yes, you speak to the leaders of, I guess, is it the proper term, radical Islamist sects or movements? Is that the proper term?
Yes, radical Islamist, it's exactly the term, but there is two or more organizations. There is Al-Qaeda, as you know, because they were responsible of the September 11. But now there is also ISIS, the ex-Islamic State, and a lot of groups, they are in connection with them, but I think the ideology is the same. It's the same for all the groups, and also it's the same in Saudi. In Saudi, Wahhabism is not very different for the ideology, because what we wanted to show in the movie, it's not only individuals. It's an ideology. It's not the idea of somebody who have problems with the society, with sexual problems, social problem, I don't know, psychiatric problem. It's a question of ideology, and this ideology is very powerful, very much more important than 20 years ago, the first time when I meet these people, because I was in Afghanistan at the time of the Taliban, when they were at the power in Afghanistan, and I was the only one to make a movie at this time with or about them. At this time, it was only in Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, in some part of Pakistan, and in some mosques in the world. Now it's much more important. I think in the Arab world, it's like 15% of the people they are influenced by 15. This. 15%, and it's a lot of people. And the fact is, the people don't want to recognize that it's always they are saying it's the idea of somebody who has problems, and it's more interesting or more dangerous. It depends on your point of view, but it's more interesting to know what is in the head of the people they are in front of us. Because for them, we are in front of them.
Yeah, the the people that you interview, they're not crazy at all. They're very level-headed. I mean, but what they say, what comes out of them, is very difficult to digest, because they're so radical, especially with, there's a section, long section in the movie where you talk about Sharia law, and you have documented video of people losing their hands, people getting caned, and the severity of their belief system. It boggles the mind, but at the same time, the people who are espousing this and speaking about it, they're pretty level-headed and they're very direct. How did you get them to open up to you? And did you just present them questions and they were open, or did you have to work them into being so forthright?
They are not open, absolutely not. But I'm in contact of people since 25 years, before Afghanistan.
Established relationships.
Yes. With some people, not with exactly these people who are in the film, but I have contact in this world. And for them, I don't know why it's a reference to be accepted in 2000 when I was in Afghanistan with the Taliban regime. To make a movie in this condition, for them, it's like a reference. I don't know why my film was not for the Taliban, exactly not, but to be there, they were very jealous of that. And also, I did the film with a friend of mine who is not director, but is a journalist. He's a Mauritanian director, journalist living in Paris. And he's Muslim. I'm not Muslim, but he's Muslim. And it was easier for them to talk with me because I was with a Muslim. Because me, I don't know what they had in the head, but maybe to convert me, I think they have not too much chance to do it. But the idea when you are with a Muslim, it's easier. But these people are very difficult to find, difficult to contact, it's difficult to organize appointment with them because all the secret service of the world, the American, French, English, Israeli, they are trying to kill them. So are very afraid, and they are right for that. But now I think with the internet, with Twitter, with Facebook, with Instagram, with Telegram, it's, if they want to answer, they can answer. They have to decide. Many people that we contact, they never answer. But sometimes it was like 2 or 3 months between two interviews that we did. Mm. But they can answer. It's easier than at the time before on internet. When I was in Afghanistan, for example, in 2000, it was no internet in Afghanistan, no contact, no mobile phone. So it was impossible except to be in front of the people to ask them directly. Yeah. Now it's possible.
Yeah. What you're showing is a very severe, very hard mindset or ideology. And it seems like the West has been trying to deal with this in various ways, going to war with these people, I guess giving them aid. Is there anything the West can do to soften the grip that this ideology has on people? Or does that softening need to come from within the Islamic community?
I think it's impossible to make a deal with them, except sometimes for military reason or in some place. For the ideology, no, there is no possibility to deal with them. And I think also for Muslims who are not in the same mood, it's also very difficult because they are treating them as apostates. They are not really Muslims. No, there is no solution for them because they are thinking Islam is a final religion. It's not one of the religion. It's a final religion. Everybody must be convert to Islam or killed. Somebody say it, it's a guy with a red barb.
Yeah.
In the movie, he says that. When we arrive in a city, when there is Christian, Jews, a bad Muslim, we give them 2 days or 3 days to decide if they want to be convert. If they don't want, we kill them with a sabre. Sorry, yes. So I think it's very difficult to deal with them because there's another reason also. They don't trust really in the life on earth. They prefer the life in paradise. After the death. So it's a reason they are very, very dangerous, maybe much more dangerous than Nazis in the past or Red Khmer, because all these people, they were not trusting in life after the death. Yeah. So with people like that, it's very complicated. It's an explanation of the terror attack when they explode with bomb around them, when they don't want to go in jail, when they make terror attack like in Charlie, in Paris, or in Bataclan, some place like that. It's very, very dangerous because there is not the rationality of us, the rationality of the Western world that we have since I don't know almost 2 centuries or 2 or 3 centuries, that everything is rational. They have no rationality. They have a logic, a religious logic, and they're very clear, very dangerous, but very clear. But they have not our rationality, and that's the biggest difference with Western thinking, pensée occidentale.
Yeah. As this film goes out into the West and is seen by people, I can see that some people would be even more against Islam and even more distrustful of Muslims in general. Do you think that you present in this film a path for people to understand the difference between this radical sect of Islam and Muslims in general? And if so, how does the West get along with Muslims and protect itself from the radical element?
I think it's not only the West, it's a Muslim world. We must be different and to say they are different from these people. The film was shown on the Iraqi TV, Tunisian TV, and it was a big debate. I was also there, and I was with imams, very important imams from Salafist part, from the cool Islam part also, and with military, with different people. In the Islamic world, it's very dangerous. They killed a lot of people in Iraq, in Syria, in Tunisia, in Algeria in the past, in Egypt now. Yes, it's much more dangerous. So I think it's important to recognize this tendency. It's a minority in Islam, but it's very, I think to show them and to show it's important to understand the difference with the rest of the Muslim community. Because if we don't say that, that can be very dangerous for the other Muslims, because the people are thinking, I know in France, I don't know if it's the same in United States, but that the power don't want to say the reality, they don't want to say that all the Muslims are terrorists, and in reality they are. If people if the people can see this movie on they can understand they are not all the Muslims who are like that. And I think it's very important. And I trust since I'm born that there is nothing to cachée. To you have to say the things. It's the best way in life.
Become educated
for the society, but it's also in the couple, everywhere. It's important to say the things. When you don't say the things, at the end, it's worst.
Well, this is the problem. If you can't reason with a radical group, then you have to enter into battle with them. If you can't use words and thoughts, you have to use the sword or the gun. And then using the sword and the gun creates more and more problems as people get killed and more innocent people get run over and then they get radicalized and stuff like that. It seems like there's no way to win. There's no way to deal with this problem. Any solution is failure. Are you hopeful about it? And what should we be hopeful about?
I'm sure that the military solution is not a solution. It can be a solution in very specific case. I think maybe in Mali, I was there. At the time, they were at the power in the north of Mali, and they were very close to keep the capital, Bamako, where there is 1 million of people or more. Hmm. I understand very well that the French military army make intervention to block them in the north. But in general, I think military is not the solution. You have to convince the people with better ideology. But it's difficult. It's very, very difficult because they know, as you can see in the movie, they know very, very well the Islam religion. And you have to be very, very intelligent in your knowledge of the Islam to have a contradiction with them to try to convince them. But I think it's the only solution. It's not the military or police solution. It's not a way. It can be when there is a terror attack, it can be a way after, but there is no way to
change hearts.
To change hearts, and I think when you kill people, you're right. Some new young people, they are very impressed by these people who killed a lot of people. It's like in Scarface, when you're the worst guy and you kill everybody, you have a lot of admiration.
Become a hero.
Young people, yes. Become a hero, yes.
What about an economic solution? It seems like, is this a correct assumption that the most radical parts of Islam come from the most poor areas or the most oppressed or economically not wealthy? Is it an economic thing or does that pair with why people are glomming to this ideology because they don't have anything else in the world and the world is crappy, so they'd rather believe in something that promises something better than this world?
I think there is no solution with economy because the terrorists are not often not very poor. You see the pilot for September 9/11, it's they were from a rich family of Saudi. So in France, a lot of terrorists, they were not very poor. There are some poor people, but it's only one of the component of the...
Yeah, one component.
Of the things, the economy. The radical Islamists, they use all the contradictions of the world to convince young or not young people, because they are not only young people. You see, the terror attack in London, they were all people 55 years old. Like, they are not all the time very young. Sometimes they are very well educated. It was statistics about terror attack in Iraq and in Syria. It was people, they were very well educated with a lot, they were at the university and they never hesitated to have a bomb around them and to explode in a market, in a street, to kill the people. It's not a question of intelligence or economy or different. But the economical problem can be also one of the components of that. For example, in the suburbs of Paris or Toulouse or Lyon, yes, it can be one of the components. But I see the component of the contradiction in different countries can be more important. For example, in Mali, they use the contradiction between black people from the south and the Arab people of the north, Tuareg, people. So they and it was an operation since 50 years from the black people that had the power in Bamako against the Tuareg in the north. They use that, but they use also in Iraq the contradiction between Shia and Sunni. Hmm. And everywhere they use a lot of contradiction who are in the different countries. And they're very, very intelligent for that. When you're reading the press of these people, I don't know if it's a real press, like Dabiq, it was the newspaper on the internet that the Islamic State published every week or something like that, in French, in Russian, in Chinese, okay. In Spanish. It was very not stupid things. They write.
Yeah.
They say, for example, we will attack specifically France on Belgium because there is a lot of Arabic people in this country, it is maillon faible, I don't know the term, the best place in Europe to make terror attack, because there is much more contradictions than in Germany, where the people that are coming, Muslim, are coming from Turkey and they are not Arabic, or in England where they are coming from India or from Pakistan or Bangladesh. So the analysis are not stupid. These people are not stupid.
And in let's say Western Europe, there's a lot of tension between the people who are native to Western Europe and then the immigrants. And there's probably a lot of prejudice or difficulty navigating that situation. How does a film like yours help the tensions between, let's say, Arabian or originated Frenchmen and people who have, been in France for thousands of years, right? The natives, let's say. How does looking at radical Islam help these two groups to come together in order to work against this thing in unity?
I think radical Islamism is it's important in the number of the migrants. The problem in Europe is not the fact of the migrants are coming. It's the number. It's the number, because in some countries the percentage of the migrants is very important. You see Hungary, the reaction of the people, because it's a small country, it's with not so much people, they have not the habitude to have Muslims in this country. So the number was not so important in 1 year or 2 years, it will be no problem, I think, because Europeans, they can accept Islamic people, Muslim, when they accept the rules. But the reality, some people they are not accepting the rules. Radical Islamic are using the fact that these people are not speaking French, are coming like that. And also it was, for example, some problems in the attack of the terror attack in Bataclan, for example. The majority of the people that participated to the attack, they were coming with the migrants, as the migrants. And the problem, it was only the extreme right who say that before. And at the end, the people they are understanding that the extreme right, some with things like that, they are saying the truth, and it's very dangerous because the people in this case, much more people can be convinced by the ideas, the very dangerous ideas of the extreme right. So it's the negation of the reality. It's a problem. It can be that is a more important problem than the question in general of migrants is, I think in general there is no problem. When it's a specific problem, it can be a problem. Yes.
Yeah, politicized. And yes. do you have any worries about your safety now that you're putting this documentary out? Do you think that you'll be vilified by, you know, your countrymen for political reasons and kind of vilified by the Islamists for the radical Islamists for putting this documentary out there?
But the reality is I was very, very afraid to make the film because it was very risky. We were like 1,000 kilometers from the military people. We are in the end of these people. But we were safe at the end. The problem is the censor on the movie protect me because they were very happy to I was very afraid of them, of the reaction of these people if the film was released. But when the film was forbidden in France, they were very happy when they are talking, the French government is forbidden the movie.
It's censored in France.
Yes. Huh. Yes. The film was censored in France. Yes. In yes. On the TV and also it's very
for
it's
what reason?
Because they say the film is making publicity for Islamism. It's not true. It's absolutely not true. It's okay. Exactly for me the contrary. But they say that at the beginning, I was a lot of very important people like Claude Lanzmann, like the Darden brother. A lot of people they write articles to say it's you don't understand the reality. It's a most important film about radical Islamism. But the film was forbidden. He protect us. Never the radical Islamists say a good thing about the movie because I think they don't understand exactly what the way to do this movie because it's not for them. Also, they understand that very well. Yeah. So never on internet, on Twitter, on Instagram, and everywhere, they write a word to sustain the movie. But it was a protection for us until now. I don't know what's happened in the future. Okay. Maybe one day, one guy can decide that they have to kill us. But for the moment, it was like a protection for us.
I guess we'll see more of the effect that it has in the world when it goes into a wide release. What do you expect the reaction to be when everybody can access this?
I hope that the people they will understand what's happened in the world because I think after every terror attack, the people try to forget. It's a human reaction. I understand very well, but the problem is not solved. So I think you have to see the reality in front of you, and you have to try to understand who is in front of you if you want to fight against them or to change the things. It's very important, and I think the film can be a small contribution to that. My idea since I'm born and the idea of my family and also is more you understand the things, more you can make progress in your life and in the world. It's very important not to be blind.
Mm-hmm. So this is another little window into what's going on in the world.
Yes, exactly.
And hopefully this will help.
Yes, and I think it's one of the most important problems of the world because it will not change in the 20 or 30 years.
Yeah. Since you've been watching it, it really hasn't changed.
Yes, no.
Yeah,
no.
And you don't think it's going to change on its own?
No. It's not a question of election. It's not a question of to change a president or something like that. It's more and more present in the Arabic world, in the Muslim world, and also in Europe. So I think it's very important to understand. And also, even to maybe in the future to deal with them, but I think for the moment it's not possible.
So are you hopeful or are you skeptical about the world, especially this portion of it? Do you think it's possible for this to work itself out? Or is it just going to be getting bigger or maintaining the same kind of percentage?
No, I'm not optimistic for that, but I'm optimistic in life, about life in general. There's, I think every problem has a solution. So, but sometimes it can take 50 years to find a solution or more. So, but no, I'm not optimistic for that because I don't see the things are changing on especially in the Arabic world where the inequality, there is so much difference between between rich and poor, where there is no democracy. I think it will be worse and worse and very dangerous, but. In life, we have to be optimistic. If we are not, we have to suicide.
So be hopeful or else.
Yes, absolutely. In my personal life, I meet good people, but in the world, I'm interested to meet bad people, to know what is in the head of people when they are bad.
The one thing about the documentary that really persists in my mind about is that you don't put a lot of filter on it. You show people as people. You humanize the people. You don't vilify them. You don't bring them down and call them names or anything like that. You just show them as they are. And in a way that shows us that all of us could be in that situation too. Like any given one of us could be in that seat saying that it's correct to cut off somebody's hand for stealing a dollar. And that provides some beginning of a bridge that might be the way forward.
Yes, they are humans. They are human beings. So I remember very well, some people in France asked me why you film some people before books. I say I was in their home. It was a lot of books. I will not oblige them to go outside to say they don't know how to read books. They don't read anything. No, they are like that. You can be a very bad person and to be very very cultivated. Yeah. So a lot of Nazis were very cultivated. They like classical music. They love piano. They were very very good for that. You can be very bad and very intelligent, culture. Yeah, you have culture. So it's humanity is like that. So it's important for me to know that, and I think it's important for the other people to know it. Yes.
I wish you very, very much luck in this endeavor. I think it's very important, a service that you've provided, an inside look into something that people know is out there but don't really, have never really seen before.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. It was very complicated to do, very risky, and I think it's important to open the eyes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.